Hello, everyone. Troy from Ampeg here. NAMM 2018. So stoked to have Darryl Jones with us. Thanks for stopping by.
Thank you, man. Thanks for having me.
I want to start off by talking about you did a recent gig in your hometown of Chicago at the Promontory. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
Well, basically, there's a gentleman named Eric Hamburger who's doing a documentary about me. And since the basic premise of the documentary is, to lack of a better way to put it, side man goes up front, kind of thing, And so we needed to get, some footage of me playing my songs and singing and, doing a gig. And so we decided while we were recording, why not do a gig in Chicago? It's hometown, warm reception and all of that. And to really kind of workshop the effort and get it up and going. We're actually going to do another one in Chicago, March 9th at Park West. So trying to get my career as an artist going,
And do we have any release date or anything, or there's got to go through the whole mixing and cutting and editing?
We're hoping to be finished with the filming of the documentary in the fall, hopefully early next year release or late this year release.
Okay, we're looking forward to that. So you did the No Filter tour. It was a Baker's Dozen shows over in Europe this past I believe it's October. You want to tell some stories about that?
It was a great tour. We had a great time. It's great to be in Europe, almost any time, summer, spring, fall is great. And, so the band is, we've been doing these little runs where we go out, we rehearse for a couple of weeks and then we go out and do 6 weeks. Been doing that once, twice a year. So everybody's kind of on the same page and we seem to be staying there. So instead of us like having to pick up, go back two or three steps after not touring for a year or something like that. Everybody's kind of, staying with the program. So it only takes a couple of weeks of rehearsal and everybody seems to be playing great, man. I have a lot of Stones fans, who've been there for a long time telling me they think the band's playing better than ever.
So this year, I assume we can see more of these dates, these little runs, 6 weeks here and there. U.S. possibly?
It hasn't been, it's still in pencil in my book. But yeah, we're thinking, maybe in the springtime. Yeah, I should say we're thinking like they're thinking. I'm following them wherever they go,
I want to talk also, there was a tour in Latin America in 2016. And you also played in Cuba, the open air free show. Yeah, you want to talk about that a little bit?
And that was just a blast. First of all, that was my second time being in Cuba, and I love it there. I really love it there, man. People are so dialed into music and culture and art, and the audience, man, was just amazing. Just amazing. It's like, despite the fact that the Stones were, and all of that kind of music was illegal until very recently there, people know the songs, man. People were singing just like as if we were anywhere else in Latin America, So it was a very special gig. And I've actually had a few people come to me and say, man, have you watched the Havana Nights thing? And I'm like, well, no, I haven't really watched it. I'm slow to watch, my own work, But they told me, you should watch it, man. He says, I've seen like more than a dozen Stones shows. And he's saying that was something special. It was actually Bob Dylan's bass player, Tony Garnier, told me that I should watch it. And, we've done a bunch of gigs with him, so he would know. So apparently, and it felt to me like something special happened on stage that night, actually. I was actually really happy. I don't know. It was one of those times where I was on stage and I was thinking to myself, this is pretty cool, like really drinking it in.
Had a chance to kind of pinch yourself, so that even that happens after everything you've been through, you still have those moments where you're like, you pinch yourself and like, this is a pretty cool experience.
Absolutely, yeah. No, it's interesting because every once in a while you're looking and you go, wow, that's Keith Richards right there. It's pretty cool. Yeah.
And I believe the that show, it's called Ole Ole Ole. Is that right? Or is that
Havana Moon is the name of that. Is the name of that. Yeah. There's two different things about, there's one about North America, I mean, North, about Latin America. And then there's the Cuba gig. Yeah. Right. Havana Nights. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So earlier at the clinic, you were talking about, we know you've played with Miles Davis, you've played with Madonna, Eric Clapton, the Stones, Peter Gabriel. The list is immense. Is there anyone on your list who you haven't played with that's kind of on your bucket list?
You know, there are a bunch of like, you know, the jazz masters. Yeah. I have dreams in which I'm, you know, I've studied acoustic bass and have my chops up on that instrument, and I'm out playing jazz gigs. I mean, be great to play with, you know, any of the, you know, elder jazz cats who are still around. I'd love to, you know, to do that, you know. And I got to really get my thing going. So I'm excited about getting that off the ground. That's probably foremost in my mind, to get my thing up and off the ground, you know.
Everyone calls you the Munch. I've looked high and low for a story. Why are you the Munch? What are the origins?
It's one of those stories like, you know, what do they say? If I tell you, I have to kill you. No, I'm just joking. It's not that deep. It's a derivation of Munchkin. I was actually, and apparently my father too, late bloomers. So I didn't start growing until I was 15 years old. And so up until that time, I was about 5 feet tall. And so the elder, the upperclassmen, when I started, you know, playing in high school and started playing with the older upperclassmen, they said I had to have a nickname. And so it was Munchkin, which got shortened to the Munch. And that's, you know.
Exactly.
Yeah, even some people, like, go to Chicago and call some old friend, get their mother on the phone, and they're like, well, who shall I say called? I said, well, tell him Darryl called. Who? Tell him Munch called. Oh, hi, Munch. I mean, people's mother know me by that nickname. So, you know, who would have thunk it, you know? Wow.
Stuck around all that and all those years, and I'm still alive.
Yeah, right. There you go.
So playing live, what Ampeg gear do you rely on, or does it vary by venue?
Definitely varies by venue, but my go-to is the SVT. It's a great rig for nearly every application that I play in. And I'm one of the lucky recipients of an 8x8 cabinet that is a little bit smaller, a little bit tighter sounding, you know, a little bit more compact, but still got the, you know, got enough oomph to get the job done. So I'd have to say Ampeg SVT.
And in the studio, I assume it's something a little bit different, or?
B15, you know, I use the B15 in the studio, yeah. I'm again a very, very lucky recipient of one of the Heritage B-15s. Dina was kind enough to have it decked out in white Tolex, so it's pretty special. I'm excited about that rig, and it sounds amazing.
So probably like a one of one, the Darryl Jones, the Darryl Munch Jones B-15. Okay, so NAMM, we're 3 days in. Have you had a chance to walk around and check out some other cool stuff?
A little bit. I got a little bit to do today before closing time. But I always enjoy coming, you know, first of all, checking out the great gear and hooking up with the companies that I'm associated with, you know, with Ampeg, I'm a long time member of the family. And of course, you always run into, you know, old friends and stuff like that. So I enjoy the NAMM show. I like being here. Yeah.
All right. Troy again from Ampeg. We're at NAMM 2018 with Darryl Jones. Thanks so much for stopping by.
Thank you for having me.